you for the introduction. Hello and good afternoon. I'm glad to be here. Can you hear me better? Can you make it a bit louder? Thank you. I'm glad to be here in Ghent. It's really a nice location, a nice city, and I thank the organizers for the opportunity to present some of our work and some parts of the SCAPE project that I will be talking about. It's only a part of the SCAPE project because I'm focusing on the work that we are doing at the Austrian National Library. A short overview. I will give an overview on the SCAPE project. I will show application areas that we have at the Austrian National Library for the SCAPE project, especially web archiving and the Austrian Books Online project. I will then show what the environment is that we set up for the SCAPE project, which is the hardware setup and the open source software architecture. I will show a few application scenarios and the lessons learned from it. So the motivation behind is we have an increasing amount of data. That is not a secret. We all know that. All the memory institutions are facing this situation. And with the challenge to preserve large amounts of data, we need also tools that help us doing this. You all might have heard of big data. But what is big data? Big data is a buzzword. It's vague. It has not a lot of meaning. But what is big data in the library context? So there's actually no definitive threshold that could tell us in gigabyte, terabytes, or petabytes when big data begins. So what LinkedIn, eBay, Twitter, and so on understand under the term big data is completely different from what smaller memory institutions mean by that. But the general idea behind it, it's a massive growth of data to be stored and processed. And if the memory institutions are facing a situation where solutions that are usually employed do not fulfill the new scalability requirements anymore. More concretely, we are pushing the limit of conventional database solutions. And for example, the simple batch processing becomes tedious or even impossible. And this is where the SCAPE project comes into play. A short overview about the SCAPE consortium. It's an FP7 funded project by the European Union, led by the Austrian Institute of Technology. We have 16 partners from national libraries, data centers, research institutes, and universities, while the national libraries and data centers are the content holders, and research institutes and universities develop new solutions, and the commercial partners try to adopt these solutions into their commercial products. It started 2011 and runs still until mid-end. It's not clear because there is an enlarged version of the project, so it might run until end of 2040. A global picture, so it's a big project, so it's structured into sub-projects, and the core of it is the so-called platform. The platform is basically a core of Hadoop. For me, just to be informed, how many people of you have heard of Hadoop or MapReduce? Ah, that's good. That's really good. So I can go a bit into detail about technical things. So the platform is around this open source product Hadoop and many things around Hadoop in the ecosystem. And we have preservation components that are tools that modify data, like, for example, an image migration from TIFF to JPEG 2000, or tools for analyzing the content of images and so on that are the preservation components. We have planning and watch components that help us to do the planning of our preservation. So what should we do facing a specific situation with the collection and specific problems? What should we do? Should we do in such a situation that are planning components? We have the test beds that are environments in the content holding institutions that participate in the project and try to implement those technologies and evaluate them if they fit the needs. And then we have a take-up sub-project that cares about what I am doing, for example. The focus of this talk is the test beds. So it's the environments, it's where we employ and evaluate the tools. in a nutshell, for all of you, MapReduce, Hadoop, what is it? So we start that we have some input data. So the input data can be a text file, a large text file, or it can be many, many image files. And what we do with MapReduce and Hadoop is we split these input data into different splits so that we are able to run our tools in parallel. So our data must fulfill certain requirements so that we are able to do that. But the principal idea is that we split the data so that we can run it on many machines, and we parallelize. We have a fine-grained parallelization, which means that not only the machines count as the instance for parallelizing the processes, but also the cores. So if you have one CPU with four cores, you have actually four instances for running the process in parallel. If we split our data into input splits, and in one task running on one core, it's again splitted into records. After that, we have a phase where data is aggregated again. So this is actually the reduce phase. To make it simple, think about that you are calculating the average of something that's a typical reduce function. And there are a lot more steps in between that I leave out now, because that would be too much detail for this talk here. And you can then decide to merge at the end the data, then you have the output of such a MapReduce job. That is, at the Austrian National Library, a dedicated environment that we have for the SCAPE project. So it's a very small cluster. So imagine that Hadoop and similar companies are, they have clusters with thousands of machines where they're doing their jobs. So we have four machines and these are the slaves, so you can call them like this. This is the master, the first is the master, and these are the slaves. They have to obey and do their job. And they have each a CPU with 8 hyper-threading cores. And in the configuration, you decide how many tasks are assigned for the map phase. So for example, for the parallelizing of the jobs, we have 25 assigned for the map tasks and 10 for the reduce tasks. So this means in the reduce phase, it's important that you can also parallelize these jobs so that you don't have a bottleneck. That's the basic idea behind MapReduce. The picture here is when the machines have been delivered, so now they are in order. The platform architecture is that we have, let it call, a digital objects storage. So it's not a repository. We have also a repository, and this will be implemented during this year. It's a Fedora-based repository that we use as a reference case for showing what we can do if we load data from the repository. All the small files, the so-called small files, are HOCR files, so HTML files, if you want, that encode layout of a book page image, text files, METS files, WARC and ARC containers from web archiving. That are the files that we store in HDFS. This is the distributed storage space. If you want, take all the hard disks that you have in your cluster, sum them up together. Basically, that's the distributed storage space you have. On top of that, you can run MapReduce, but that's not where it stops, because MapReduce is a very basic function where you do something very concrete. So what you need actually, and what you should look after, is to have some solutions from the ecosystem like Hive, Pig, HBase. So many solutions that fit very specific needs are built on top of HDFS that you should carefully look after. We have then what has been mentioned today already by Herbert van der Sompel, is the Taverna Workflow Engine, which we use to orchestrate jobs, which is available via a REST API. So we can call a job or a chain of job that is executed via the workflow engine, which then executes a series of jobs that I will be talking about. I will now come to the application scenarios. The first one is web archiving, and then I have three scenarios from the Austrian Books Online project that I will look now more into detail so that you get a feeling what are the things that we can do with this kind of stuff. First, about the web archiving scenario, a few key data about what we do. We do domain harvesting, selective harvesting, and event harvesting, have currently about 20 terabytes of data. And here you can see that the data, the amount of data is incrementing quite heavily. And this means if we go to analyze this data, if we want to know details about the content that we have in the web archive, we need actually software, and we are preparing now the steps to have software available that is able to process the whole web archive if need be. How can we imagine that? So from Heritrix, the web archive, the crawled web content is stored in an ARC or WARC container. So in this ARC or WARC container, you have JPEG, GIF, HTML pages, and the MIDI file, for example. You have lots more in a real WARC file, but just as an example. You need then on the Hadoop platform a specific reader, because Hadoop is made for large text files, and the default case is that you have, for example, a large log file where one record is one line in this log file. So what you need, if you have a different kind of file type, you have to tell Hadoop how to read the data and what is a record. And that's the input format where you explain how to read records from your data. And that's what we created based on the Heritrix Web Crawler API. You have then a MapReduce job, which iterates over all the files that you have in the R container and applies an identification job that tells you what MIME type you have. And in the reduce phase, you do the summing up and count how many instances do you have for each MIME type. That's one possibility to run such a MapReduce job in the context when you want to know what file types do I actually have. So not what MIME types are reported by the web by the crawler, but what MIME types do you actually have in your archive. If you now look at different problems here, you can see that the throughput that you get when running the job on such a cluster can be very different depending on the way how you integrate the tool. You can do an API call, you can do an external call to the command line version of a tool and so on. And this might have a serious impact on the throughput. So this is something that you, in this case, must look at, and you must do studies on what is the best way to perform such a tool. In this case, the native MapReduce was the best way to go. The other thing is that it's not linear. So it means if you increment the amount of data, Hadoop gains a lot of advantage that it can choose the right nodes where to fetch a data block, because data is stored redundantly on the distributed storage system. Another advantage that you get from that is that you also have a secure backup if you have, for example, three replica of all the data blocks. But the best thing here you get is that you have a growing throughput of data that you can process. The more data you have, the more throughput you will get from the Hadoop system. And if you look at the comparison of different tools, then you get into the conceptual study of how to employ different identification tools. They have different granularities. They have different kinds of output. So you can merge them and compare them. But that's another story. But that's something we do in this context. Some key data about the Austrian Books Online project. It's a public-private partnership with Google where only public domain material is scanned. The objective is to scan 600,000 books during 6 years. So we have passed now 2 years, 4 years are left, with a total of about 200 million pages. Currently, 70 project members are involved, not full-time working on it, but are somehow involved, 20 in the core team. And so far, we have scanned 130,000 books with 40 million pages about. So when it comes to big data, you can ask if 130,000 books is actually big data. But it really depends on the granularity, how you look at things. So if you go to a book has a book page. A book page has a paragraph. A paragraph has lines, has words, has characters. So, and as far as you go down, you can create a lot of data. And if you do that, you are facing big data, and you will most probably not be able to do it without such a system. In the context of the Austrian Books Online project, a simple view on the process is that the digitization is done by Google in the public-private partnership. we have from HathiTrust a way to store our data in a so-called pear tree, which is an efficient way to scalably store data on file servers. We have then a quality control step where we apply some automatic procedures to find specific problems and also to get a view on what are the kind of problems that we have to report to Google in this early phase of the project. When we discover that certain failures happen systematically, we have a good chance that Google can change the procedures and correct such errors. And the purpose of all that is certainly that we can access the files. We have now a viewer online, which is since a few weeks online with the first 100,000 books. What kind of scenarios could we look at there? So imagine that you have a large collection of images and you want to do a TIFF to JPEG 2000 migration because you want to reduce the storage cost, or you have migrated the images and want to migrate back to TIFF because you see the risk of obsolescence whatsoever. So the challenge is here, pictured on the diagram on the right side, you do a conceptual workflow that enables you to do this image migration, which is not only converting the image from A to B, but it's validating the input. It's about validating the output. It's about doing the actual conversion, certainly. It's also about comparing the original and the target image if that fits correctly. So it's not only one step migrating the image, but it's a lot of components that play together and that do the actual job. This is then a workflow. In Taverna, it's like this, that you have on top data comes in and the data flow is going down with the output at the bottom. And the question is then, how can we parallelize this? How can we make this efficiently run on a Hadoop platform? And we have several alternatives to do that. We can split it horizontally or vertically, which means that we can, for example, run several instances of the workflows in parallel, or we can split the execution steps by each other. And we must carefully look at each step. How can we find a way to have a really efficient version that runs on such large collections? And that's the kind of study that we're doing there. The second thing is about a use case where we compare different versions of the same book. This can be, the reason for this can be that images have been manipulated, cropped, rotated, you have applied some image enhancement procedures, and the images are stored in different locations, and then you want to know what you have two versions of the same book, what are actually the differences between those books. And the challenge here is that this is very computing intensive, because imagine that two versions of the same book could also have duplicates in one book page. So that means you do not have a correspondence of page one is page one, page two is page two, and so on. But it can also be that page two is page three, actually, in the second version. So the calculations are therefore quite computing intensive. At the moment, it runs about 4.5 hours per book, which is a lot. And we are working hard on reducing this, because imagine you do it on 130,000 books. This becomes really quite impossible. And we still have some time left in the project. The AIT is a part, the Austrian Institute of Technology is our partner who is now working on that to improve this. The next scenario is to do quality assurance. So actually, you have the books, you have the pages, and you have a certain format in which the pages are stored. The book page, the book containers in our case are METS files that aggregate the whole content and reference the file instances. We have the page images stored as JPEG 2000 image files. We have a layout file, a page layout file containing text as well, which is in HOCR format. And if you want now to extract on several levels data, and for example, you want also integrate external catalog data into your database that you want to use in your Hadoop jobs, you must do some kind of extraction, transform, and load processing, because you have one data format, that's our databases in here in METS HOCR format, and you want to transform this into a queryable form so that you can do an SQL-like query to do an analysis of what's in your data. If you look at such an example, we have created such a prototype workflow that does it. We first collect all the paths of the file instances that we have on the external file servers. The image files are too big to load them into our cluster, so we leave them on the external file server. But the small files, which are the METS files and the HOCR files, are small enough to aggregate them completely in the cluster. Therefore, we read all the paths to those images and aggregate the content into... sorry, I have to start with the first one. We, using the images on the external server, we can, for example, read metadata from the images. I'm using here an example where I read the image width, simply as an example, from the image using EXIF tool. Then I take all the HTML files, which are the HOCR layout files from the server, and aggregate them into one large sequence file, because that's what Hadoop likes. Hadoop likes to process very large files. So I can aggregate all the files I have there and put it into my distributed storage system. And then I have Hadoop MapReduce job. And to tell a bit about the background, what this MapReduce job does is we have a quality assurance problem here where we want to analyze if the width of the book page image differs significantly from the average text block width that we have in the layout HTML pages. Because if that's the case, we assume that this can be an indicator that we have a cropping error with text loss. And so if we can extract those examples where this happens on many book pages and say, okay, maybe on this book we have a cropping error with text loss, and extract them and then manually review the books if that's really the case. But the machine helps us just to extract the samples that are suspect. And finally, the output of our data we load into Hive tables, and that's the means to make the data available in a way that I can do an SQL-like query and analyze the data. I will show you an example of this. And we do finally a Hive select, a test query, just to see if the workflow worked. So if the data is made available correctly so that I can use it. This is the example of reading the image metadata. On the left, you have the file server. We have gathered all the JPEG 2000 image paths. In parallel, the Hadoop cluster reads the images from the file server and outputs. On the right side, you see just an example of an image with value, which can run, you see it down here, for 60,000 books and 24 million pages, about 5 hours using this cluster, which is still quite some time, but let it run on your laptop and you will see that it becomes nearly impossible. The sequence file creation is, what I said, aggregating the HTML files as one example, where I read all the HTML files from my file server, and also in parallel, I let aggregate the content into one large sequence file, which is then for the 60,000 books about 1 terabyte large. And then we have the MapReduce job, where we take as input for this MapReduce job the sequence file. It has the input data has always, when we talk about Hadoop, we talk about key value pairs. And so in the sequence file, we have the key, which is the book page identifier, and the value is here, the content, simply the content of the HTML file. We read in parallel the sequence file, and in this case we have a real MapReduce job where data is available in HDFS. That means each data node can choose the best data block location that can be on different servers, which is good because by that way you can avoid I/O bottlenecks in doing this MapReduce job. And you see that after the map phase, we do the aggregation, which is here simply calculating the average paragraph width, which then outputs here an average value of the paragraph width, because we want to compare if it differs a lot from the image width. The time, you see again, six hours for running this MapReduce job. And we then load the data into our Hive tables. In this example, it means we have our output data from the MapReduce job as text. And in Hive, we have a simple way to transform this text into a table. This is significantly different from what we have in data databases. Because if you load data, let's take, for example, a MySQL database, you have kind of an ingest procedure that validates the data, and this can take quite some time. In a Hive database, we do not do that. We simply say, Hive, this is your table, and this is the text file that that corresponds to it. Now read it. And if you have wrong data in your database, that's your problem. So you must care about making sure that data is valid. So you have no schema here. When you have that, you are able to execute analytic queries because you have the two tables and do what you usually would do with an SQL database. So you can do a joint query and say, okay, give me all image width and give me all average text block width values in a combined way. And then it would be easy to do a calculation. Where is the difference, the average difference, very high? Extract those books and then have a look at them. That's the use case that we are looking at here. What have we learned there? From this experimental cluster that we have at the Austrian National Library, we see the emergence of new options for creating large-scale storage and processing infrastructures that are being discussed in the library community very, very strongly, which is, should we use HDFS as a storage master or staging area? Completely different approaches. So I see that often that you have your data storage, which is normally backed up with tape backup and so on, and has its own mirroring strategy and so on. And then you have a small cluster that you only use to load data into your cluster. But you must think about the whole idea behind the Hadoop and MapReduce stuff was to bring computation to your data. Because usually the program that you apply is a few megabytes large. So that means moving the data, that is cost intensive because it's a lot of data that has to be moved around. But bringing an application to the data, that's cheap because it's not large, just, and that's what the Hadoop system does automatically. It copies the jar, as many files as you need it to your cluster to execute every task in an isolated JVM to make the complete job execution possible. And if you think about or look at big players like Hadoop, Yahoo, for example, you see that they, in the last year, at least they pretend they've never lost data in their very large clusters with a simple redundancy of 3. So they store each data block 3 times, and they never lost data. So it's a real option, and it's cheap. So because the Hadoop cluster uses hard disks that you can buy around the corner in a normal shop. It's simple hard disks that you can plug in, and therefore it's a cheap option to the expensive options of the large storage systems. We have then the question whether we should have a local cluster or rent a cloud infrastructure. So many institutions rent an EC2 Amazon cloud, for example, and load data into that cloud and then do the job execution there. You can experiment locally with your data. You have an image of your Hadoop system that you can load into this system and then execute it in an outsourced way. So new options arise for doing large-scale processing that you have then to think about. From our experience, we can see that Hadoop is not an open source system where you say, okay, there is a nice idea, but there you have to do many tweaks to get it running. No, it's really it offers a stable core that is ready to be used in production. And it's important in the different use cases to look at everything that is around in the Hadoop ecosystem, like HBase, Hive, PIC, Oozie, Yarn, Ambari, and the list never ends of solutions that you can use for very specific requirements and needs. If you want further information about this, we have the project website, scape-project.eu. We have a GitHub repository, which is, the project is still running and admittedly currently a bit a mess, but we have the strategy to publish everything as soon as we develop it. So it's there, people can have a look at it, and if they say it's there is a problem with what you are doing, you can comment it right away. That's why we publish as soon as we develop all the time. We have a project wiki part. Many parts of the project wikis are open and available. The tools that I mentioned, if you are interested in looking at that, is the Scape platform built around Hadoop. The link is here. I mentioned, or not really mentioned, but implicitly mentioned a tool for JPEG 2000 validation that is being developed in the Scape project, which is the JPLizer, which is documented here. And I mentioned a tool developed at the Austrian Institute of Technology, which is this matchbox image comparison. Quite an interesting tool if you do workflows that have to do with images. It's not only a tool that does book comparison, but you can build workflows around image comparison. It does a feature comparison of images, where it extracts features from images and then compares those images. And they made sure that it works with text image files. So that might be an interesting option to build new workflows. The AIT is building the workflows using Python, so you can simply move things around and build new workflows out of it. Interesting to have a look at this, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you for your